I'm Pastor Price. This is my wife, First Lady Pamela Price. We'd like to thank you for joining us here at Living Epistle Facebook Live, our Bible training session on this evening. Before we begin to get into the Word, we're going to open up with a word of prayer. So if you will, wherever you are, if you would just bow your heads with us. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this time and this opportunity to get into your Word. I ask that you would open up our hearts, open up our minds, and help us comprehend and understand what you're saying to us tonight through your Word. And Father, we give your name the praise, the glory, and all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God.
Thank God.
Amen.
Amen.
This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
The Holy Word of God.
The Holy Word of God.
It is my food.
It is my food.
Water.
Water.
Light.
Light.
Strength.
Strength.
And final authority.
And final authority.
Through it.
Through it.
I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed.
And reconciled unto God.
And reconciled unto God.
Now, as I hear the Word of God.
As I hear the Word of God.
Faith will come.
Faith will come.
Through faith.
Through faith.
Salvation is mine.
Salvation is
through
mine.
Faith.
Through faith.
Healing is mine.
Healing is mine.
Through faith, deliverance is mine.
Through faith,
prosperity is mine.
All of God's blessings,
all of God's blessings,
they are mine.
We have been doing a series of studies on Bible words that all believers should be very familiar with, and we're continuing that on tonight. And there are some words that we're going to look at. And again, it is my belief and my conviction that every believer should be familiar with these words. They should be able to talk about them and use them intelligently and with understanding, because this here, it signals their growth and their maturity in God. So with that said, we are beginning our lesson, and the word we're going to begin with on tonight is the word legalism. Legalism. Let me give you my working definition. Reliance on keeping or following to the letter a standard or the law, rather than the spirit or having rather than having a deeper understanding, which includes adding of human rules or standards as a basis to be accepted.
You may want to read that one more time.
I'm going to read it again.
You can't read your own writing, can you? Go ahead.
Reliance on keeping and following to the letter a standard or the law, rather than the spirit of the law, or having a deeper understanding of the law, which includes adding of human-based rules or standards as a basis to be accepted. And that's legalism. That's when you either come up with your own standards and you're depending on some other standard, and you're following that, you know, thinking that that's going to be enough for you, rather than the letter of the law. Mm-hmm. I'm getting a little confused. The spirit of the law. So with that said, let's begin. There, to help you understand it, we're going to look at Matthew, the 23rd chapter. And this is going to help us clarify. I'm going to be reading it from my Christian Standard Bible, the Tony Evans Study Bible. I'm going to be reading the 23rd chapter of Matthew, reading from that. And as we go through it, you're going to see how Jesus calls some people out. He's going to call them some names, and some of the names that you've heard us talk about, and we may talk about them a little bit more, but you're going to hear them, and you're going to understand and recognize some of the things that are happening and going on, and as Jesus goes through this. So with that said, I want to begin Matthew, the 23rd chapter. It says, first verse, then Jesus spoke to the crowds and to his disciples. The scribes and Pharisees are seated in the chair of Moses, a position of honor. He says, therefore, do whatever they tell you and observe it, but don't do what they do, because they don't practice what they teach. Mm-hmm. Jesus is telling his disciples, watch those guys. They're saying something and they're doing something, and what they are doing is not in alignment. They got a position of leadership. They're in a position of authority, but they're not using it right. But let's go a little bit more. He says, they tie up heavy loads that are hard to carry and put them on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not or aren't willing to lift a finger to move them. So he's saying here, this is what they do. They come up with rules, regulations, and things, and they put them on the people. They burden the people with these things. And when they see the people struggling with them, struggle on. Don't try to help them. Don't try to give them any understanding. Don't try to encourage them, but struggle on. Mm-hmm. You struggle on with it.
And a lot of times if they bend the rule or disobey the rule, they're going to chastise them for it.
Yes. But let's go on. Fifth verse. He says, they do everything to be seen by others. They enlarge their phylacteries. And remember, in a lesson prior, I talked about that's when they take pieces of paper and write the word on them and tie them in these little leather straps and boxes on their wrist or right here on their forehead. They did that. And he says, and they lengthen their tassels. This is a garb that they wore on those robes. He says, they love the place of honor at banquets. Want to sit up front? Sir, would you sit back here? No. I'm going up front. At banquets, the front seats in the synagogues, greeting in the marketplaces, and to be called rabbi by people. But you are not to be called rabbi because you have one teacher, and you are all brothers and sisters. Do not call anyone on earth your father. Let that soak in for a little bit. He says, do not call anyone on earth your father. This is not talking about the man who played a role in your birth into the earth realm. He's not talking about him. But this here is talking about in the church. Let's go on here. This is why. Because you have one father, which is in heaven. He's basically saying, don't replace him. Mm-hmm. Don't replace him. The Father in heaven has supplied you with everything that you need for life. Don't call someone here on earth your father who is putting these burdens on folks and not helping to the degree. But let's go on.
Because you think about it, these people are really esteeming them over God. The word of God.
Yes.
What he has established, the laws, the commandments he's put in place. They say, you know what? No. We're going to enlarge the borders of our garments, mm-hmm. and you all are going to have to do this. And you say, well, God said this, but no, we're not going to do that. We're going to do this.
We're going to do it this way.
Yes.
He says, you are not to be called instructors either, because you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. Now, just those words alone goes against human nature. Human nature wants to build himself up, put himself up. But Jesus is saying, if you want to be put up, go down first. Mm-hmm. But let's go on. He says, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. For you don't go in, and you don't allow those entering to go in.
What does that mean?
Think meaning that,
pass by.
Yeah, talking about you're not doing a good job and the right job of teaching and preaching the truth. You're adding this here. You're adding that. You're overburdening them. When this gospel is very simple.
Mm-hmm. And then the ones who want to go in, they come in and...
And they
cut it off.
Not only cut them off, but they won't provide them all that they need to fully make it in. Mm-hmm. You see, they won't teach them how to take advantage of the blessings. They won't teach them what are the blessings, what are the promises, all of these things like that. They're lacking in their supply to the people, and therefore the people are going to be lacking.
Mm-hmm. I've noticed, since Ashley and I've been doing DYD. I've noticed that there is an element. We found out that there are people that want to keep their sheep, or because they're the under shepherd. They want to keep their people suppressed as far as the word of God is concerned, as if I need them to keep coming back to me. I don't need them knowledgeable in the word.
Whoa.
Mm-hmm. As if I, we don't want your children. We really don't want our children to study at the house. We really don't want them that sharp or knowledgeable in spiritual matters. because I need to, them to be dependent on my church. Yeah. So this is a part of that. That's why I mentioned that.
15 verses. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You travel over land and sea to make one convert. And when he becomes one, you make him twice as fit for hell as you are. Because of the false doctrine, the false teaching, and everything that is not in alignment with the word, they've been teaching them traditions. They've been teaching them the old way and what they feel is. Accept the word. Oh my goodness.
And this fits into your definition of legalism.
Legalism.
Because this, what it is saying, this is what we've carved out as far as our denomination is concerned. You can't do this, you can do this, and you can't do this, and if you cross these things, then we're gonna have a problem.
We're gonna have a problem. 16 verse, he says, woe to you blind guys. He's calling these people that are in leadership position blind guides, who say, whoever takes an oath by the temple, it means nothing. But whoever takes an oath by the gold of the temple is bound by. Is what I mean, he's saying, you're these little bitty things you're tripping over, but the big things, the weightier matters, you're just going past. He said, blind fools, for which is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctified or set apart the gold? He says, also, whoever takes an oath by the altar, it means nothing. But whoever takes an oath by the gift that is on it is bound by his oath. Blind people. For which is greater, the gift or the altar that sanctifies or sets apart the gift? He says, therefore, no one who takes an oath by the altar, altar takes an oath by it and by everything on it. The one who takes an oath by the temple takes an oath by it by him who dwells in it. And again, he's pointing out they got some things twisted. They got some things twisted. And the one who takes an oath by heaven takes an oath by God's throne and by him who sits on it. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. He said, you pay a tenth of mint, dill, and cumin, which are spices. He says, and yet you neglected the more important matters of the law. Justice, mercy, and faithfulness. Just bring them tithes on. Don't worry about being, you know, being right in word, but you know, just bring it on.
Yeah. I mean, here is the Son of God, the Messiah, telling them. And they are ignoring this, but he is just laying it out. So if you think for a minute that Jesus was passive, you need to read this right here.
Because anytime you stand up in a man's face and call him blind and a hypocrite.
Those are strong words.
Those are strong words.
Yeah.
And I'd like to think when he said it, he didn't bat an eye.
And you think about that's why they were messed up. It's like, who is this guy?
Yes.
Who is he?
Yeah. By what authority? But let's go. He says, these things should have been done without the neglecting of the others. And again, the things that are most important, the spirit of the law, justice and righteousness and mercy, all of that is tossed out of the way. And they are majoring in the minors and minoring in the majors. He calls them blind guides. He said, you strain at a gnat and gulp down a camel. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. Greed and self-indulgence
is the root of this.
Greed and self-indulgence. He said, you take the time to clean on the outside, to make sure you're looking good, you're shaved, you got your berries and juices in place, you got your hair cut, everything is tight and right and everything on the outside. you're exercising, you're keeping yourself in shape, and all, you're eating a special diet and all this and that. But on the inside, there is greed and self-indulgence.
You know, this is always baffling because it's hard. This is actually going on today.
It is.
Pharisees and Sadducees.
It is.
And you hate to kind of admit it because it's baffling because you're saying these are actually Christians mm-hmm. that this type of behavior is happening with.
Yes, it is. 26 verse, he says, blind Pharisees. He says, first clean the inside of the cup. And he's telling them, your cleaning needs to start on the inside. Your speech needs to get in alignment with the word. Your heart needs to get in alignment with the word. Your motives, your motivation, what motivates you, all of these things, the things that are inside, these are the things that need to be cleaned up. That's what he said, inside the cup. He says, so that the outside of it may also become clean. Think about it in the natural sense. Mm-hmm. A cup or glass, it could be really clean on the outside, looking good. Well, you know, as you're looking away or, you know, you got a little distance. But you get close up on that joker and you look on the inside and you see some gunk or something in there. You're not going to want to use it.
Uh-huh. Well, you know, you think about it. This is what's happening is you got the spirit and then you have the flesh. The flesh, you're dealing with the five senses. You're dealing with this body of how things mm-hmm. looks and how things are perceived. But Jesus is telling us to clean up, get that spirit in check. You know, now that you got the seed of God in you now, mm-hmm. now develop that.
Develop.
Clean that up. Get that.
Clean it up.
Get it up.
Because
clean it up.
When you come to Christ, and I can tell you this, and I've spoken this long, long, long time ago, many times, in reference to my speech used to be jacked. Mm-hmm. And I hear, I'm a witness. He can straighten up your speech, excuse me, if you allow him to work along with you.
Mm-hmm. And this is where some people feel like they're, you know, they're not going to get any better or it's not capable.
The word.
They're not capable of getting better.
They can.
Yeah.
But they don't want to get put in the way.
Yeah, exactly.
He says, 27 verse, woe unto you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You are like whitewashed tombs, which appear beautiful on the outside, but inside are full of the bones of dead and every kind of importunity. He says, in the same way, on the outside, you seem righteous to people. Hello, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. But inside, you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness, mm-hmm. meaning that there is no stopgap measures on the inside of you.
Mm-hmm. And you know, that's why it's so important, especially to, you know, like those who are wanting to get married or they start dating someone. You know, you want to pay attention because what's on the inside going to come out.
Yes, Lord.
You know them by the fruits that they bear.
Yes. 29th verse says, woe unto you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. He called them that again. You build the tombs of the prophets and decorate the graves of the righteous. And you say, if we had lived in the days of our ancestors, we wouldn't have taken part with them in shedding the prophet's blood. Because back in the day, what Jesus is referencing, that there was a time in which when these prophets and men of God that were called to preach and teach this gospel, it was so cutting. It was so revealing. It was so reading their mail that they even kill them.
The prophet, yeah?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
They kill them. He said, so you testify against yourself that you are descendants of those who murdered the prophets. He says, fill up then the measure of your ancestor's sin. 33rd verse. Now he's gone from calling them scribe Pharisees and hypocrites. He said, snakes. There was this comedy show we used to watch, and there was this guy on there. He used to say, sneaky snake. Mm. And this is what he's calling them. He's saying, snakes, brood of vipers, how can you escape being condemned to hell? He says, this is why I am sending you prophets, sages, and scribes. Some of them you will kill and crucify. Some of them you will flog in the synagogues, in the church house. He's talking to the Jews. He said, y'all are going to beat them in the church house. By the system that you have going on, you are going to ostracize them. You're going to make them feel like outsiders. You're going to really put them through the wringer, all because they are teaching and preaching the truth, and they are not standing with you, but against you, because you mm-hmm. are on the wrong side. Mm-hmm. Let's go on here. He says, synagogues and pursue from town to town. He says, so all the righteous blood shed on the earth will be charged to you, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, son of Bechariah, whom you murdered between the sanctuary and the altar. Truly, I tell you, all these things will come on this generation. Look how Jesus addressed these people. In our modern day and time, we cannot think that the addressing that Jesus did here is only applicable for that time then. It's applicable now.
I was thinking, you think about legalism. Some kind of way creeped into the church. And you see how Paul was trying to flush it out when the Judaizers came through. And they were trying to get them circumcised, and Peter kind of cooperated with it for a minute, and he tried to check him, and
yes.
and how it got in the church then. And in some kind of way, legalism crept into far as clothing and makeup and different things like this, mm-hmm. and a form of works, even in that manner.
Amen. And let's go to Galatians 1:1. We have to do a little bit of reading to get to the part that I want us to see. So Galatians 1:1, Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ. And it's important that you understand that. Paul is saying here that I am an apostle. I have been sent forth. Now, not by man, but by Jesus Christ himself. He says, and God the Father who raised them from the dead. Paul is saying, this who sent me. This is by the authority that I write this letter, this epistle, Galatians, and I share this information that they sent me. But let's go on here. Second verse is, and all the brethren which are with me unto the churches in Galatia. He says, grace be unto you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world. Now again, he's laying out some important information as he begins to lay out his argument. He's laying out some awesome information, talking about Jesus Christ who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from the present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now he comes to the sixth verse. He says, I marvel, I'm shocked and amazed, that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace or the unmerited favor of Christ unto another form of news or gospel. Mm-hmm. You church folks, I mean, you how is it? But let's go on here. He says, seven verse, he says, which is not another. It's fake. It's not true. It's not accurate. He said, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you, because this is what happens when legalism is allowed to run amok and not challenge. Mm-hmm. It will cause trouble. Mm-hmm. It will cause trouble because people will be, it's easier for them to put their trust and reliance in the steps or the things of legalism mm-hmm. rather than the word of God, because the word of God will cause you to implement discipline. And folks are weak when it comes to discipline. Mm-hmm.
I think knowledge, when they lack knowledge, this is when you fall into the trap of legalism, because it takes an effort to combat some personality that has sitting in a high position.
Yes.
And especially if they were to embarrass you in front of somebody and you're like, well, am something wrong with me? Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So that knowledge is important. That's why each one of us, the word of God encouraged each one of us to be strong in the Lord.
To be strong in the Lord. Seven verses, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert, twist the gospel of Christ. I mean, think about it. Going back to something you mentioned earlier, if legalism comes in and it becomes a thing of works then, I work to please the pastor. I work to please the first lady. If I raise this money for her, that gets me in favor with her and him, and then I get elevated. But Jesus already told us, if you want to be elevated, you know, humble yourself.
Yeah, it's interesting. Because, you know, when you said, and would pervert the gospel, and we know from the last scriptures that you were reading that the reason that the gospel is getting perverted is because of greed.
Mm-hmm. Let's go on here. Eighth verse. He says, but though we are an angel from heaven, preach or proclaim any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye receive, he says, let him be accursed.
Do you think Christians are too trustworthy? Trusting, I would say, others?
I say to a degree to the fault of them. Mm-hmm. We want to be. We want to think good. We want to be trusting. But what I have learned over the years, not only am I to, you know, I got to watch and pray. Meaning, I've got to study my word. I've got to have a relationship with Jesus Christ myself. And I have to watch the leadership. If there becomes an issue in regards to them not following the word or saying something that the word is totally, then there's a problem.
But I think everyone is not strong in that place. You find weak-minded people or just feeble-minded people.
They have to be. They need to.
And they tend to just trust someone else's studying or wherever they've gotten. And a lot of Christians don't think. They don't allow they allow their reasoning capacities, you know, in your soul realm to go the other way, but they don't use it for spiritual matters. And so, unfortunately, that when you're not thinking and allowing the whole, you know, because usually when you a cow is eating, they say pick it up and, you know, chew it and spit it back out and chew it and spit it back out.
Oh, just swallow. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And so with the Word of God, you have to do the same thing. You have to pick it up and let the Holy Spirit bring things to you. But if you won't allow yourself to go into thinking, there are many Christians that won't think, allow the Holy Spirit to do something, change their mind.
Mm-hmm. Let's still in the book of Galatians, let's go to the second chapter. He says, then 14 years after I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas and took Titus with me also. And I went up by revelation and communicated unto them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to them which were of reputation, lest by any means I should run or had run in vain. But neither Titus, who was with me being Greek, was compelled to be circumcised. Now Paul, he was called to minister to the Gentiles. And this gospel that he ministered to the Gentiles, a part of it said that you do not have to adhere to the rite of circumcision. And here he is having a Gentile, bringing him around those of the early church, And then he says here in that second verse, he says, but neither Titus, who was with me, being Greek, was compelled to be circumcised or take in that particular rite, because that rite, R-I-T-E, in the Old Testament, was for the Hebrews. But now that Jesus has come, he's bringing them out of that. But let's go on here a little bit more. Fourth verse. And that because of false brethren, unawares, brought in, who came in privately to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage. They came in. They saw how we were growing, developing, and just growing by leaps and bounds in God. And they tried privately and in a sneaky way. They checked them out, and then they wanted to bring them in unto bondage, which going back to the things of the law or implementing forms of legalism.
And mm-hmm. It's as if you have to come in and stop that. When you see Satan running through, yeah. It's like, I got to catch this now.
Got to. Mm-hmm. That's what a strong leader should do. Let's go on a little bit more. Still in that second chapter, let's go to the 11th verse.
You know, it's amazing because, you know, we've been pastoring for a couple years now. And there's been time when I've seen something coming and you can see something working through somebody. And actually, you can't even do anything. It has to take its course. You can see it ahead of time.
Yeah. Some things, yes, definitely. So, still in the second chapter of Galatians, let's go.
He has something he's trying to say. Oh.
I think it can bother people when you aren't in a struggle like they are.
Yeah. 11th verse. But when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face, because he was to be blamed. Just for a moment here, I just want to say this is Paul confronting Peter. Now, one of the things I think over the years, and we have kind of been taught that these guys were, for lack of a better term, wimps. Mm-hmm. That these guys were wimps. To help bring the point in, Peter had a fishing business. Now, I myself, I've not done a whole lot of fishing, you know, what you're doing with the nets and everything. Mm-hmm. But I can only imagine. You out there, you're bringing in a net. This is your business. This is what you've been doing all your life, you know, young. These guys are muscle bound. These guys are no pushovers and everything. So let's look at Paul. Paul himself, what he did on the side, he was a tent maker. Now, let's think about the ground out there in that area. It's kind of desert-like, hard ground. And can you imagine the strength it is required to erect a tent and hammer those tent pegs in a hard ground? Paul wasn't no punk either. So now you got some guys. Mm-hmm. And Paul's saying here, 11 verse, but when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face because he was to be blamed. Mm-hmm. So these are two, you know, kind of strong-willed men having a confrontation. But when it comes to the gospel, Paul was ready to to correct his brother. Yeah. And he wasn't afraid. That's the point that I'm getting at. But let's go on. Before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles, but when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision. In a nutshell, he basically, you know, when the Jews weren't around, he was eating bacon. He was eating some pork chop. He was eating some ribs.
Y'all got some good food over here.
Yeah, I mean, he was eating it. But then when the other Jews came around, oh, no, I don't.
Put away that pork.
Put it away. Don't even bring that shellfish around here anymore. Those scrimps and that lob. Don't even bring that around here.
I guess I try to wonder about Peter at this point because he... It's like he knew better. He had had a vision.
Yes.
But it's amazing when you prejudice against something.
Yeah.
It takes more than just a vision.
Yes. Yes. You made a great point there. Look at 13 verse. He says, and the other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas also was carried away with that dissimulation. Think about it. I mean, this guy Barnabas, this brother Barnabas, he was like just flabbergasted. Come on. Here you are, your brother. Look what you're doing here. You're talking about grace. You're talking about faith. You're talking about favor. You're talking about the law being all done away with. And now you want to keep the law. But when the Jews are not around, you're eating pork.
You know, somehow I would say Barnabas started participating in what they were doing.
That's possible too.
Yeah.
It caused an issue.
Yeah.
14 verse. He says, but when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel. The truth of the gospel, it is not in the pork. I mean, if you make a conscious decision, that's not what you want to eat, that's fine, well and good with you. Mm-hmm. But if you're saying that it is for a religious reason or it is a reason that you want to be closer to God, you can still eat bacon and mm-hmm. be close to God.
Yeah. And the thing about it is that Paul is trying to stop this legalism before this get out of hand.
Because this food, this diet, is only a part of a greater picture.
And Peter supposed to have been strong enough to stop, because he was over the Jews. Jesus had put him over that.
To minister to them.
Yeah.
And even he ministered to the Gentiles before. But let's go on here. He says, but when I saw that they walked not But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all. Paul confronts him before them all.
He didn't pull him to the side. What?
Thou, being a Jew, livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews. Why compellest thou the Gentiles to live, as do the Jews? He says, we who are Jews by nature, who were born Jews, are not sinners of the Gentiles. He says, knowing that a man is not justified or made right by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we Jews, might be justified or made right by the faith of Christ, and not by the works or the acts, he says, of the law. He says, for by the works of the law shall no flesh, whether they be Jew or Gentile, no flesh is going to be made right by adhering to the law or legalism or coming up with their own form of legalism. You're not going to be made right. Mm-mm. You cannot outdo what Jesus Christ has already done so that we can be justified. He says, but if while we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves are found to be sinners. He says, is therefore Christ the minister of sin? He said, God forbid. He says, if I build again the things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. Mm. If I build again, he's basically saying, Peter, I remember you went to Cornelius's house and preached the gospel, and they received the Holy Spirit just like you did. And the other one, you had Jews there who visualized that. And they spoke in tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And all of that good stuff that you were doing then, and now you're doing this here. He said, if I do that, he said, and I make myself a transgressor. Mm. I destroyed the law, and then I build it back up. Come on, man, get it right.
And you're a leader. You're causing confusion here.
Confusion. He says, for I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. He says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the trust, reliance, and belief, followed up by my obedience of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God. For if the righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain.
And when you look at it, Paul was given the revelation of redemption, right?
And we're going to talk about that later on.
Paul was given that revelation, the question could be asked, do you think Peter didn't have that full revelation, but he knew enough?
I would like to think that he knew enough.
Yeah.
And again, they worked, how should I say, just different lanes or fields, so to say, mm-hmm. because they were alive during the time. Both of them were alive, you know, to a degree for each other mm-hmm. and everything. But
it seemed like Paul had a stronger revelation because yeah. he was given how the kingdom of God really and was operating.
And he was, you know, chiefly designedly sent mm-hmm. to the Gentiles.
And you think about it, the gospel has been sent to the Gentiles more so because we gravitated to it.
Yes. Bless his name. All right. So we've gone over legalism. So it is my hope that from the things that we've shared and gone over tonight, that you do have an idea what this legalism is all about. So now we're going to look at another word that believers need to know, the word ransom. Ransom. This is it. A price paid for someone else's freedom. A price paid for someone else's freedom. Let's go to Mark 10:45. Mark 10:45. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered to, but to minister and to give his life a ransom to pay the price for many. Mm-hmm. This is what Jesus is saying here in this scripture. And he's saying, you know, he summarizes his entire mission. He said, I came not to be ministered to. You know, that's not my main focus. He said, my main focus is to minister, you know, to give his life or my life, he's himself, a ransom for many. Still in that same thing. Let's go to Romans 3:21. Romans 3:21.
You know, he says that word minister to, because of who he is. He's a mm-hmm. king. He's Son of God.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't come for y'all to just be bowing down worshiping me. No, I came to do something different.
Yes, to do something different. 21, Romans 3:21 says, but now the right standing or the righteousness of God without or on the outside of the law is manifested or being made known, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe. For there is no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Jew can't, you know, brag, or the Gentile can't brag. All have, you know, sinned and come short of the glory of God. Missed the mark. 24th verse says, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood. We'll come back to that later. To declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. He says, where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? He says, of works, nay or no, but by the law of faith. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Now, it is in those scriptures that we talked about, or we see, especially that 25th verse, talks about how God set forth to be a propitiation, and that is a price tag that had to be paid. That's what it really means. Jesus paid the price tag. There was something else I want us to look at. Let's go to Ephesians 5:1. Ephesians 5:1. That will help us understand this ransom thing, because something had to be paid. Ephesians 5:1. Paul tells the church in Galatia, he says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty of freedom, wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage.
You said Ephesians what?
I'm sorry. That's Galatians.
Oh.
I'm sorry. Ephesians. Ephesians 5 and 1. Yeah. Okay. He says, be therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ has also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for sweet smelling sake. He paid that price.
Yes.
He paid the ransom. Mm-hmm. He paid the ransom.
You know, yes. A lot of these terms are spiritual terms that you have to understand or get an understanding in the spirit.
Yes.
And it's amazing. Your mind can't just comprehend this. You have to get go in the spirit and kind of comprehend what is really being said about that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, because again, like you're saying, you know, this series dealing with spiritual matters, and the Holy Spirit will help you if you begin to build that relationship and allow him to do that. There's something in Titus I'm getting to that I want us to look at, 2 and 11.
It's a little harder to see these type of terms. You said Titus 2?
Yeah.
These terms with a fleshly view. You have to understand it in the spirit realm. Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So Titus 2 and 11.
First Titus?
Titus.
Oh, Titus.
Titus 2. Mm-hmm. Titus, the second chapter. It says, for the grace or the unmerited favor of God that bringeth salvation or soteria, safety, preservation, and soundness, hath appeared unto all men. Hath appeared to all men. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, thinking right, righteously, and godly, where? In this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. We are to live with anticipation, looking for Jesus to readily come back. 14 verse, pay attention here. That 13 verse ended with our Savior, Jesus Christ. 14 verse, who gave himself for us. Who gave himself for us? Who gave himself for himself? No, he didn't do it for himself. He said he gave himself for us that he might redeem. Now we get a new word here, mm-hmm. and we'll talk about this one a little bit later. Redeem. He says, today when I was studying this, I remember, you know, listening to Miles Monroe and him breaking down words. And he said, whenever you see re in front of a word, that means to do again whatever it was after that.
Mm-hmm. From deem, right?
Deem means to buy.
Mm-hmm.
Redeem means to buy again.
Uh-huh.
That blessed me so much.
Yeah.
To buy again. And then I began to think, why was there a need to buy again? Because that was a broken connection.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, you know, we belong to God through Adam. And when he sinned, broke it.
Mm-hmm.
So now God has to buy us back. Because in Luke 4,
yeah.
Satan has legal.
Yes.
Let me get on. That's a little too deep. Come on back. But he said, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purity. And purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee.
Mm-hmm.
How he used to say it? Redeem.
Redeem.
Yep. All right. So again, now we're getting ready to look at another word. And it you know, as I studied these words and looked at them, they kind of work in tandem, you can say. They tell or they connect to each other. And the next word is reconcile, or reconcile, as he would say.
Mm-hmm.
And again, you have to consider the word re means to do again. Concile or concile means together. Mm-hmm. So now to bring back together or re-bring together, mm-hmm. back together. Reconcile. Mm-hmm. The bringing together of two or more entities that were together in the past, but whose relationship has become strained or tenuous. Romans 5 and 10. Romans 5 and 10. Let me get Chanda. Romans 5 and 10 says, "For if, when we were enemies, we were," past tense, "reconciled back to God." He says, reconciled to God. How is it done? By the death of his son. He says, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Mm-hmm. It is the death, the resurrection of death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ that has provided a method in which we can be reconciled or reconciled with God. Because again, I said once before, mankind and God were having a good relationship.
Mm-hmm. But Adam and Eve.
Yes. through Adam and Eve. Yeah. They were good. Yeah. Buddies. Had a great time. Yeah. Fellowship with one another in the cool of the day. Mm-hmm. And great, you know. But mm-hmm. something or someone came along and severed that. And when mankind's representative, which was Adam, when he disobeyed God, there are some things that were lost. And one of the things that was lost was the relationship with God that man had.
You know, when you think about, you know, somebody might be saying, I don't understand how, you know, what Adam did affects me. But if you think about it, when we have children, it things are passed down. And even generational type thing, curses and yes. Things come down through generations. He was man's representative. Mm-hmm. And whatever he did was going to affect the next person, the child.
And like I always say, you know, when I teach along that line about Adam being mankind's representative, we have our form of government where we have national leaders that represent us. We have state leaders and we have local leaders that affect, you know, decisions that they make will affect us. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because you think about Jesus was the second Adam.
Yes, he was. Yeah.
So what he did gave back life.
Reconcile? Mm-hmm. Yes. Brought it all back. That's why I say these words work together.
Yes, they work together.
They definitely work together. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 5:17. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself. It is all God's doing. Mm-hmm. And he's done it by Jesus Christ and have given to us the ministry of reconciliation. I want to finish with, to wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world, the people, the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. He says, and have committed unto us the word of reconciliation. With that word of reconciliation, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. We represent Christ in everything that we say and do. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. In Christ, your new creature, and you are reconciled unto God by the work that Jesus has done.
This is just a matter of believing that. You know, a lot of times we hear this, but we don't really comprehend that we are new creatures in Christ Jesus.
Mm-hmm. We are.
All this that was just read, that is you.
That is you.
That is you.
That is you. All right, let's go on a little bit more. We got a little bit more time. Let's go to Ephesians 2 and 8. Ephesians 2 and 8. 2 and 8. He says here, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hand, that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise," he says, "having no hope and without God in the world." He says, "But now in Christ Jesus, who sometimes were afar off, are made nigh or close." How? By the blood of Jesus. "For he is our peace." He is our peace. He says, "who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity," or the differences, "even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain," or two, "one new man, so maketh peace, that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity," the differences, the wall that separated Jews and Gentiles, because he already mentioned in Romans that for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. He mentioned that there is no difference between the Jew and the Gentile. They've all sinned, and that this whole thing, we Jew and Gentile both can have this by faith.
Mm. Wow.
By faith.
By faith.
That is it. By faith.
Not works of the law.
Not by forms of legalism, like laws being added or statutes being added and all this other stuff like that. Say, this is now what you must do to get it. No, none of that. But he's saying here, the middle wall that had separated us, the Jew and the Gentile, that's all been broken down, because in God's eyesight, we are the same. Mm-hmm. And the same in need of the blood of Jesus to wash away the sins. We'd like to thank you, everyone, for joining us here at Living Epistle Facebook Live, our Bible training session. We do this every Wednesday, 7:30 to 8:30, only 1 hour. Like to invite you to come back out next week and be a part of our Bible training session. And then also on Sunday mornings, where we have our Facebook Live Sunday morning worship service. And I'd like to invite everyone to come out again and share it with someone, share it with a friend, a neighbor, so that they can be a part of this grand worship experience. We bless the Lord for all that he has done. And again, we want you to come on back, amen, at those times and at those dates, to enjoy fellowshipping with us. So until next time, God bless you, and we'll see you then.